Good evening, everyone. I'm delighted to be speaking to you live from the Quorum in Gurgaon, which we're happy to report opens its doors tomorrow after a two-month lockdown. June for us has been an interesting month with our programming calendar. All our members who are used to our programming are used to us doing a lot of in-person programming, and this month we've been 100% digital. One of the few advantages of being digital this month has been that we've been able to bring together our communities, both in Gurgaon and Mumbai, on a single platform. And I'm happy to report that our club in Mumbai will be opening sometime towards the end of July. So we look forward to welcoming you all there. Tonight's conversation, we're joined by Mr. Ram Madhav, who is an Indian politician and author, and who's currently serving as a member of the National Executive of the RSS, formerly he has been the National General Secretary of the BJP, a role in which he is required to be in touch with thinkers, writers, and the intelligentsia. Mr. Madhav has written several books in English and Telugu, with the most recent one being Because India Comes First. This is going to be the focus of our discussion today. The book is about reflections on nationalism, identity, and culture, and delves into a broad tapestry of India's growth into a soft power and predicts how it will shape up over the next few decades and why India policymaking or Indian policymaking must put India first. I have no doubt this is going to be a very interesting conversation. He's joined today by Priya Sehgal, the senior executive editor of NewsX and a moderator and someone who's moderated conversations at the Quorum before. Priya, we look forward to welcoming you back in person. And Mr. Madhav, when things settle, we look forward to having you visit us at the Quorum. For all our guests tonight, please feel free to ask questions on the chat box on the right side of your screen, and we will sure to, should time permit, forward those questions to Mr. Madhav. But without further ado, I'd like to ask Priya and Mr. Madhav to take it from here. If you can put your screens on, please enjoy yourself. Thank you.
Thank you, Vivek, and it's really good to be back here at Quorum. And welcome, Mr. Ram Madhav. You know, it's good to see you, if virtually, if not in person. We hope to meet you soon. In fact, before I begin this conversation, I'd like to tell all our viewers that Mr. Ram Madhav has always been someone who I say makes RSS easy for outsiders, you know, for someone like me and most of the viewers who don't know much about RSS. I think ever since he was made spokesperson for the RSS, I think he was the second person to be made a spokesperson ever since RSS felt the need to be more transparent and to reach out to people. And he's one person who's always been there explaining things, reaching out. You know, we've been having a lot of, like I said, I may not always agree with him, but, you know, his arguments are always very rational, very logical. And we're going to see that, I think, today also in this conversation. So please get your questions ready, because I'm sure you'll have a whole lot of them. But Ram Madhav, first of all, congratulations on the book. It's been out, I think, for a while now, but those who haven't, this is the book. And in fact, you wrote this soon after the BJP, a little while after the BJP won 2019, and it was released during pandemic. I think you even mentioned you've taken COVID, the beginnings of COVID, into account over here. But so I'd like to begin with that, you know, with an excerpt from your book where you said that post-pandemic, the world will need not just a new leadership, but also an idea for a new world order. And you thought India would be taking the lead in this, given the way we had controlled the first wave. But now, having seen what we've done with the second wave, have you rethought that assumption or that this thing? Or you still stand by the fact that India can still emerge as a world leader?
Thank you, Priya. And thank you, Vivek, for having me here in this discussion session today. I am also a Gurugramite, so one day I would look forward to dropping by and see the Quorum club in person, probably. Before I take your question, Priya, since you mentioned about my association with RSS as its spokesperson, and how I try to make it easy for for the outsiders to look at RSS and understand it. You know, there is a saying about RSS that it is very difficult to understand, but very easy to misunderstand. So mostly,
and we wonder why.
Mostly, easily people get carried away by a lot of propaganda, but that when time comes, we will definitely take it up. But coming to your important question, when I wrote that particular piece suggesting that the post-COVID world order will have a totally different agenda, and that agenda requires countries like India to come forward and take the frontline role. I don't necessarily call it leadership role, frontline role, because I strongly believe that in the post-COVID new world order, the idea, the agenda items that will occupy the table will be items like climate change, healthcare from a very totally different perspective, not as disease management, but holistic health, technology that is human friendly, development that is human centric. COVID has led to some kind of rise in authoritarianism in several countries. So how to protect democracies, how to protect fundamental rights of the people, these are going to be the agenda items on the table, not necessarily the old agenda items like trade, commerce, etc. So in view of the new world order that is emerging, in view of the new agenda items that are coming under the table, India will still have a role to play. Because on all these issues, India, with its vast civilizational and cultural experience and wisdom, can definitely contribute enormously to global good. But yes, today, because of whatever happened in the last couple of months, the question of managing the COVID, the second wave of COVID, probably India is seen as being a little bit on the back foot. But I think it is a temporary phenomena. Whatever happened was certainly unexpected. It was certainly unfortunate. Our hearts should go out for those who have lost their lives and also those families who have suffered enormously in the last couple of months.
Was it unexpected? The argument is that you ignored all the warning signs. The government ignored all the warning signs.
Look, I don't fully agree with that. That kind of criticism, for the simple reason that this kind of wave, which has come like a tsunami, as everybody described it, was not easy for any country in the world to tackle. I mean, many developed countries with better healthcare infrastructure also struggled with the wave when it happened in their countries. Yes, at one level, one can say, okay, you had the warnings from those countries. Why did you not prepare for them? But the also equally important question is no country prepares for tsunamis. Countries prepare for normal situations. When tsunamis come, how do you immediately attend to that crisis is what is really important. There, I think the central government and state governments have tried their best. There are no doubt certain areas where people felt anguished genuinely. In fact, the anger or anguish of the people is not at all misplaced or not at all for no reason. There were enough reasons for people to be anguished. And we all should, I mean, those in the government and administration should all be very empathetic and sympathetic to the people's grievances.
You write in your book that democracy is in reality also the rule of the majority, at least in the current situation, the way the numbers are fallen in the BJP's plate. So to say that, you know, yes, maybe the states could have managed better. It's also, you know, at the end of the day, it is the center to give guidance to the states. And currently you and Gurugram, you said, you know, in Haryana, where both the state and the center is the BJP. So you can't even pass the buck over there. So is it fair to just put it all on states? Because, you know, you also talk in your book, the answer to this brute majority is cooperative federalism. We don't see much of that cooperative federalism happening nowadays.
These are actually two different issues. Let me tackle both very quickly. Firstly, as far as managing this pandemic, during those critical months of April and May was concerned, there was a great need for both the state and the center to work in tandem, because after all, under the constitution, healthcare is majorly the responsibility of the states. When I say states, don't think that I'm only talking about the states under opposition's control. The BJP also controls 12, 13 states in the country. Half of the country is under BJP's control also. So it is a responsibility to be shared by both. What happened, Priya, unfortunately, was, forget about tackling tsunamis like the second wave. Even basic healthcare, public healthcare in our country has not been attended to properly, given proper attention over decades. There are some states like, you know, I can talk about Tamil Nadu, which has relatively better primary healthcare or, you know, government healthcare establishment. There, they were able to manage it relatively more efficiently. But large parts of our country, public healthcare, even today remains in very dire straits. So we need to, first of all, turn our attention to improving public healthcare. Even taking into account the private healthcare, which largely is confined to 50, 60 major cities in the country. It doesn't go below that. Good private healthcare is available only in 50, 60 major cities and towns in the country. Beyond that, even private healthcare is not really sufficiently available. So first of all, we need to pay attention to that. That's one big lesson that we have learned from this pandemic. The other question about cooperative federalism is a much larger question. I mean, it is not just limited to this pandemic alone. You have seen what happened recently when Prime Minister called a meeting to discuss about the cyclone. What happened with the kind of response that we saw from West Bengal government. These are all the kind of unfortunate things that are happening, which are all warning signs for us. We have to now seriously discuss and decide about this question of federalism in our country. See, Constitution does not talk about federalism. It only talks about powers to states and powers to center and certain powers that both enjoy. There is no word federalism in our constitution, meaning Indian polity is essentially unitary. There is certain amount of power sharing that happens between the center and the states, and also nowadays the lowest unit of panchayats. Now, all of them have to have some kind of mutual respect, goodwill for each other. We have to create that kind of an atmosphere. It's not like America, where everything is watertight. States have their own power, center has their own its own powers, and there is a federal kind of arrangement. It's not like that in India. Everything overlaps here. So we need to be very, when things overlap, you need to be extra, cordial, extra friendly, irrespective of which party you belong to.
No arguments from me on that, which brings me to this overlapping business. When the prime minister becomes the chief campaigner in state elections, how then that is, he becomes the issue. It becomes Mamata versus Modi, for instance, in West Bengal. After a very bitter election, acrimonious election, then how do you expect him to sit with that same chief minister and then do governance? Because, he makes it so personal. So should he be the face of every state election?
Right from the time of Jawaharlal Nehru. But every election, leaders with mass following would always be in the forefront leading the charge. I don't think there should be any issue over whether Modi ji should campaign in a given state election or not. But the larger issue is different. See, we have abolished untouchability in our country, caste untouchability. But we have invented this new disease called political untouchability. Now, if you belong to so-and-so party, I don't talk to you, I don't look at you. That is what worries people like me. In elections, you put the best foot forward. And in politics, if there is a political party, it is there to contest elections with all its might and win the election. Politics is not charity. You have to fight it out and win. But do we, because we belong to two different parties, do we become enemies? That scenario, which we are noticing increasingly, is definitely something that every political party, every political leadership has to take seriously and address it. I mean, we should, at the end of the day, should be friends. Inside the parliament, you argue, outside, you should be friends.
What we saw during Vajpayee's time, but I think of late has become, and both BJP and the Congress leadership are to blame for this acrimonious relationship. So I will grant you that point. But moving on, you'd also spoken about, India should take the lead in various issues like fundamental rights. One of those rights is right to privacy. And that's being questioned in this war between the government of India and big tech. You know, we've seen them. First of all, what kind of a message does this send when we're taking on Twitter and WhatsApp? You wrote also in Indian Express that the new IT rules should be built by consensus. But right now, Twitter and WhatsApp are saying there is no consensus.
First of all, let me just take half a minute to take you back to the previous question, because it has something to do with social media also. Today, social media has become one medium which is creating enormous ill will between individuals and between parties and all. So parties and political leaders who are using social media, they have to be extremely cautious about the kind of messages they are putting out, the kind of visuals, the kind of statements they are making on the social media platforms, not knowing that, though they have the potential to create enormous ill will between individuals. So social media has to be used very diligently. And, probably now we have to, leaders have to reduce depending too much on social media. And, in any case, we need to use it much more carefully. Coming to the new digital guidelines that the IT ministry has come out, not just in India, Priya, I can tell you, it's a concern globally today, especially in democracies, as to how do you handle these big tech companies. They have become very big. I've written about it also in my book. Today, we are no longer even living in a multipolar world. We all, very fashionably call this world as a multipolar world. It's no longer a multipolar world. It is a heteropolar world. There are political actors as multipolar world will have them. Many countries, many groups of countries, multilateralism, minilateralism, these days microlateralism is out of the day. But there are, powerful social media groups, powerful big tech companies, an Amazon, a Google, a Microsoft, a Twitter. These are all very powerful entities. They can dictate governments. They have enormous public support, enormous financial muscle. How do you deal with them? It's a new scenario that has emerged. Earlier, we were trying to deal with them with the existing laws of the land. Whether it is India or in the other countries, they were trying to deal with them with the existing laws. But the new kind of technologies, new kind of scenario demanded countries to come up with new laws. That is what is happening in different countries today. When those things happen, there is bound to be a lot of debate. You are referring to that debate today. There will be debate. There will be criticisms. Fair enough. But at the end of the day, we need to build this larger consensus that while freedom of expression is sacrosanct, nobody should trample upon it, but every freedom ends where somebody's nose begins. So where is that limit and who will decide about that limit? There we need to probably discuss more. We are, of course, coming out with laws. Australia has got its own laws now. Singapore has got its own laws. America
is going to follow Nigeria's way.
We are also having our laws.
Are you going to take the lead from Nigeria? That's what a lot of buzz on the social media is.
No. I also saw several people tweeting that Nigeria has banned Twitter and all. They should read why Twitter was banned in Nigeria, because the president wanted to trample upon the rights of the opposition parties and other parties, and Twitter was actually giving space to opposition leaders and all. That's why it was banned. So I don't think Nigeria should be the example to showcase how one should deal with Twitter. But you can always take the example of countries more democratic, like I mentioned, Australia, like Singapore, like even France now. There's a lot of debate going on in France. Emmanuel Macron is seized of this matter. So all these countries are also seized of this issue. See, any such new situation, when it demands new laws, there will be a lot of heated discussions. But at some point, we will all settle for it. Only thing is, government should open to building that greater consensus so that the initial hiccups or initial apprehensions can slowly be removed. Today, if Twitter and other companies have some apprehensions, they should be removed.
I'll tell you the sequence of events. You know, it's not everybody says that this happened when Samvit Patra or someone, you know, the manipulated media tag was put on Samvit Patra, and then the government, the crime branch went and visited the Twitter offices. This began in February. The new rules came in Feb, and preceding that, there was the farmers' agitation. And a lot of Twitter was sent messages by the government to block certain accounts and certain hashtags. So when it suits you, you want to come down heavily. When, you know, you're saying social media should not be used. Who began the whole war on social media against political leaders? It was the BJP. Pappu Rahul ko kisne banaya? So when it suits you, it's fine. The minute it's hurting you, when questions are being raised regarding the pandemic, regarding, you know, various issues, then the government has come down with this new law. So the timing is suspect.
We must differentiate between what parties do and what government does. I don't want to comment on what political parties do, whether it's Congress or BJP. But to that specific issue of that hashtag, manipulated media, I personally feel that Twitter has overstepped in a haste. There was no reason for them to so hastily come to the conclusion. At the most, they could have taken other measures, but to say that Raman Singh is manipulating media and all that is little overstepping, definitely. And for doing that, probably they must be having some evidence. So police argues that they went to the Twitter office only to take that evidence from them. How are they saying it's a manipulative media? If they have the evidence, there's an FIR filed by Congress party, so they can look into that manipulation. Then that was made into a victimhood and all that by Twitter.
So you mean Congress's FRI boomeranged against them? That's why they were given a loophole to investigate.
No, see, police has its own version about why they went. They did not go to harass Twitter, but they only went to collect the evidence. Now, one can say, for collecting evidence, will police go to the person or the person comes to the police? These are the kind of questions one can raise. But in any case, I thought that the first overstepping happened from the Twitter side. But the larger question you are talking about, I am a fervent supporter of freedom of expression. That should not be trampled upon by any regime or anybody for that matter. But again, I said somewhere states have to take care of the question of national security at one level, and secondly, about the individual privacy and individual dignity. In the name of freedom of expression, I cannot go on defaming everybody whom I don't like. There also states have a role. And at the same time, national security concerns also demand the states to take certain measures. So we have to find that balance. That's why I'm again repeating myself. I'm sorry, it is a repetition, that this is a transition. See, heteropolar world is new to all of us. You are tackling these heteropolar powers now, heteropolitan powers. There will be a debate. I'm sure in the next couple of months, we all will settle for a better kind of environment.
But you mentioned in various ways, you know, that in terms of, you know, the use of social media, you know, by political parties, or let's not talk about government, just political parties also. Do you think, you know, and the conversation is how much of it is, you know, to blame the kind of times we are living in, the very polarized times. And for that, you know, it is the rule of the majority that is really having its way.
Nobody is an exception. There are many in different political parties. So there were efforts made to spread confusion about vaccination. I have seen leaders claiming that they won't take the BJP vaccines. I mean, these are the kind of things you are putting out on social media, which nobody is actually, you know, censoring it. If it is in the mainstream media, you will look at it, you will see if it has any harmful effects, you will screen it, you will then censor it. But in the social media, nobody is stopping it. And you are putting out messages like that. And you say a particular vaccine is bad, sounds vaccine is good. These are the kind of views that senior leaders are giving. So at the time of issues like pandemics, there needs to be a lot of judiciousness in using social media, irrespective of which party is doing it. Maybe this side and that side both are doing it, but there definitely needs to be some kind of judicious use of social media. Because that's not happening, governments are forced to step in.
No, You know, I was actually talking more about the, but you mentioned the vaccination and the politics of it. Who began it? You know, we saw the, you know, the Prime Minister going to both the centers, highlighting it, the whole Atmanirbhar, India's discovered the two vaccines, putting his face on the posters, on the vaccination slips also. So it seems that, you know, this whole thing of perception or the, you know, perpetuating the myth of one man is what is really sticking in the opposition's throat. Because as you said, the vaccination was not, he didn't do the Sanjeevani Booty. Nah? He did not do a Hanuman and carry the Sanjeevani Booty. The SII Serum Institute and Bharat Biotech did it. So why is he taking all the credit?
Priya, our problem is, I tell you, we, some of us, don't want to look at the Prime Minister as Prime Minister of India. We still look at him as Prime Minister of BJP. That's the problem when you raise these issues, like how can he go to Serum Institute? Yeah, he's the Prime Minister of this country of 1.3 billion people. If one company here comes out with an important contribution to fighting this COVID, what is wrong in that? Instead, the whole country should be saying, yes, it's a matter of satisfaction for us that we are also there to help the humanity in this hour of crisis. He is Prime Minister of the whole country. So I really don't buy this argument that why should he go and all that. He, as Prime Minister, his going has highlighted India's contribution to the fight against COVID globally. And these two companies, of course, not about Hyderabad company, but definitely the Pune company has been helping many other countries also in their fight against COVID, which is a matter of, which should be a matter of honor and pride for every Indian. At the same time, government has taken steps now to ensure that domestically there won't be any shortage of the vaccines.
But why I have a problem, I'm also reading why the opposition also has a problem and some in the media also, is the fact that, you know, he's taking all the credit, but when it came to helping the vaccine makers, there was nothing given in terms of R&D. It's only when the Supreme Court came up and wrapped them, then some kind of money was given. For R&D, really, you know, AstraZeneca and Covishield is a foreign, it was developed abroad. Bharat Biotech, yes, the R&D was done here. But was any, you know, everybody else helped in terms of grants? That's was the whole problem, was that you take credit, but where is the help? And, you know, you've seen the Poonawalla chap also saying that he was not helped at all.
No, I think that's not true. Government has helped both the vaccine companies, Indian vaccine companies, which have come out with these vaccines. Government of India has supported them and continues to support them. And today, Government of India is the one which is procuring the vaccines from them, buying the vaccines practically from them, and supplying to at least 75% of the country at no cost, at free of cost. So government is doing its bit, I think.
Also wrote that, you know, the mandate was won by the Prime Minister for a second time because of, you know, he was shown that he's a decisive man, he takes good decisions, and you know, the rest, those were basically two of his qualities that you have written about apart from others. Has the pandemic made a dent in that image of his?
History will tell us, but as the leader of large country, 1.3 billion population country with 1.3 billion population with enormous problems when it comes to basic healthcare infrastructure. I think he has tried his best. In any case, in all these matters, people will be the final judges. I only say that as the Prime Minister, as the government, they have tried their best. You can point fingers at any government at any time, Priya. That is what the beauty of democracy is all about. Okay, if there are complaints, let people raise those complaints, articulate them. But at the end of the day, people will decide.
One more, you know, criticism that the is faced, and I've seen you write articles defending the decision also, is the Central Vista project. You know, A, criticism and why do it, and B, the timing. The timing is what has got a lot of people very upset, you know, that now when money should be spent on the pandemic, when there's a global health crisis, why is the government doing a project that, is it just for ego or is there a larger purpose behind it?
No, firstly, we all should probably agree on one thing, that India's parliament, the building, which was in use since I think 1930s, early 30s, 1931 was when it was brought into use. Since then, has become definitely greatly inadequate for the growing democratic needs of our country. Now, this is not something that I am saying. This was the reason when Speaker Meera Kumar had written a letter asking for constituting a committee to look into alternatives for, how do we tackle this issue of managing so much of crowd in the Parliament House and all that. Members were not able to provide enough space for their secretaries, their staff. There was not enough space for parking. Your vehicles of media could not be allowed into the parking area. So many problems are there today with the present infrastructure. So that we need a bigger infrastructure. On that, at least there should be consensus, because it was initiated by the UPA government, not by NDA government. Now, whether we should do it today, on that, I would say the project was conceptualized in 2019. Budget allocation of 13,500 crores happened in 2020 budget. It's not any additional spending that the government is doing today. It's a five-year project. That means each year the government was supposed to send 2,700 crores. The Union Urban Development Minister came on TV to say that this year they are not spending even 1,000 crores on this project. Only two important parts of it are the ongoing things here. So one is this whole propaganda that so much money is being spent, why not give it to poor people and all that. Are we going to suggest that with some 800, 900 crores, we are going to eliminate poverty in the country? All measures required to tackle pandemic are being taken, 35,000 crores exclusively for vaccine, 2.5% of the GDP for healthcare infrastructure. That is what the government of India has earmarked for the first time, 1% more than previous years. So government is tackling pandemic and other needs efficiently with required attention and all. At the same time, this is an ongoing project. Every state has allowed for ongoing infrastructure projects to go on. Why are we making exception to this project? So whether it is legally or it is constitutionally or it is propriety wise, I don't see anything objectionable in it. But if your objection is to the question of political optics, leave it to parties, leave it to the leadership. They will face it if there is any issue about political optics. Otherwise, I don't think there should be any objection to this project going on in its own pace.
No, because you've written, in fact, I like this phrase of yours, which you wrote in one of your essays, that you accuse the Congress, of course, of converting public infrastructure into personal legacies. Now they are saying, Modi ka ghar ban raha hai. That's what is being said about the Central Vista project. That's why I'm asking.
Well, first of all, let us take it seriously. It's not Modi ka ghar. It's the Prime Minister's house that is being built. Now, why that situation came that you have to build a new Prime Minister's house? I hope your viewers knew about it. The first prime ministerial house after independence was what is the Nehru Memorial Museum today, the Teen Murthy building that we have today, Nehru Memorial Museum and Library, NMML. That was the prime ministerial residence until Nehru was alive and until Nehru was the prime minister until 1964. After Nehru's demise, that important building was taken over and it was converted into a museum in the name of Nehru. And today, remember, I don't know, you must have seen Prime Minister's residence many times. Prime Ministers live in three separate bungalows. They have to shuttle between each bungalow for each work. You need to have a proper house for Prime Minister in this country. Similarly, you don't have a separate house, a proper building for Vice President of India. Vice President occupies one of the buildings that, in the Lutyens Delhi area. So these are the things that have become necessary because of certain things that have happened in the past. So these are all requirements. It's not Modi's ghar which is being built. It's the Prime Minister's house. 10 years from now, 15 years from now, somebody else becomes Prime Minister, he will occupy that house.
Fair enough. I'm going to now, you know, I've got a couple of questions that have come in, so I'm going to ask you some of those. In fact, one of them actually deals with an issue I wanted to discuss with you, the RSS-BJP equation. The question is that senior leader, Mohan Bhagwatji has recently made a remark कि क्या जनता का शासन क्या प्रशासन सभी गफलत में आ गया है. Basically, does it mean that does this line mean that the RSS leadership is unhappy with the way the Modi government is working?
No, whatever Bhagwatji had to say, he had said it openly only. So I don't need to interpret it separately. I will only say that probably it is a matter of fact observation by the RSS leadership that somehow, somewhere, the administration and people both came under a spell of complacency that had led to certain immediate problems which were subsequently tackled. I think it was a matter of fact observation.
Because a lot of people are saying that during this crisis, we did not see RSS workers. It's actually the Youth Congress that has really taken credit for the on-ground work and seva and helping people. RSS is known for this. Why were they missing?
I tell you why. So if this interview was being done by me, it would become a bigger news than Priya Sehgal doing it. Because Priya Sehgal always does interviews. If Youth Congress does that thing today, then it becomes news. Because RSS are, yaar, wo to karte hi hai na. Unka kaam hi wo hai, hamesha 70 saal se kar rahe. I think RSS has done a lot of work in last, not just in 2 months time. I'm talking right from the time of pandemic one, first phase of the pandemic, through the last more than a year. Fabulous, phenomenal ground level work the RSS cadres have done. They have taken care not only of people in villages and towns and in colonies, but also even those migrant workers, those people traveling by trains, even providing food for them and all that. Lot of great work RSS people have done. But again, if RSS doesn't do it, that becomes a news. If RSS does it, it won't become a news. But for Youth Congress, if they do it, you have to find a news in that because they will do something to report.
I'll grant you that. But the, you know, for our viewers, the RSS-BJP equation, you know, it's been called the umbilical cord. I think L.K. Advani called it. Are you the watchdog? You know, we've been told that so-and-so leader has been summoned to the RSS office. What does that mean? You know, is it for a dressing down or is this a confabulation? What happens?
Okay. It's an enigma. Let it remain like that. But
I just said you're going to make RSS easy for us.
I will only say this much. That ideological umbilical cord connects both these organizations. Otherwise, these are all independent and autonomously functioning institutions or bodies. RSS does its work autonomously. BJP does its work autonomously. Since they both share, number one, the umbilical, ideological or thought card. Number two, they also exchange human resources. Like I was loaned from BJP to RSS to BJP for a few years. Like that, those human relations, human resources level relationship is also there. But beyond that, these two function quite independently.
I will take your word for that. But there is the feeling that, you know, whenever a BJP leader is chosen, it's with the RSS blessings, a prime minister candidate or some important post. You need the RSS blessing for that. The BJP needs the RSS blessing.
I first of all, I don't know if somebody else also needs RSS blessings, if RSS will be ready or not. We have to see. But if somebody wants RSS blessings in RSS, because it has trust in them, it has faith in their commitment to the thinking of the RSS, if it is willing to bless, it is between those two. Why should any third person have any issue with that?
Well, one more question regarding the RSS and this thing is the RSS happy with the way the COVID has been handled?
No, COVID, it should be looked at like this. Even if a single death had happened, it should have troubled all of us. It would have troubled the conscience of all of us. It should trouble the conscience of everyone. See, nowadays when people compare that, you look at America, how many people died, we had less deaths in India, like that, I feel very pained. Because that's not the issue. Even if one person dies, it should cause a it has pain to you, and it should be your responsibility to ensure that nobody suffers like that. So as far as RSS is concerned, RSS generally wants that people should not face any difficulties in that. Of course, government has a role to play, but outside the government also, public institutions, political parties, when I say public institution, administration and judiciary, and public-spirited organizations and individuals, NGOs, organizations like RSS, all of us are responsible. If something good has happened, we are all responsible. If something which is still wanting, then also we are all responsible collectively.
I haven't really answered my question, but you've given some kind of this thing. Lot of questions on the big tech. You said that big tech, Facebook, Twitter, WhatsApp, etc., needs to be regulated. For what exactly do you mean by that?
No, because today, there are situations like, for example, Twitter deciding as to which message is legitimate and which is not legitimate. For example, for last more than a year, almost it's coming to 2 years now. Donald Trump is out of Twitter. He's not being allowed to come back. At one level, one can say it's a private company. Who are you to say whether they should allow somebody or not? But it's at another level, it's a platform where people have the right to articulate their views. When that platform gets the bandwidth from the government, it has to be at some level answerable to the governments of the day, not just government of Modi alone, governments everywhere. You are raising so many questions about government of India, but the authoritarian regimes are trampling upon the free speech, even of mainstream media. No comparison. I'm not suggesting at all that you should compare India or America or Australia or Singapore with some authoritarian regimes. But even that extreme is also not good. So what I have been saying is, while you have a new situation in the form of these big tech companies, which I described as heteropolitan situation, in this heteropolitan situation, you need, see, what is happening is, if you don't make laws, a new laws for the situation, you recall what happened with Disha, Ravi and Greta Thunberg.
That is actually one of the questions that's come. So good you did that.
No, we had to invoke the archaic laws of sedition because we don't have any other laws to deal with such kind of acts. So in the absence of laws for the current situation, we are resorting to draconian laws like sedition law and all that. I mean, they are British vintage laws. So in any case, India needed, the given situation demanded new set of laws or new set of regulations to be promulgated. I tell you, when such heinous crimes like rapes happened, did we not promulgate laws from time to time when situation demanded that existing laws were insufficient? That's the way we should look at it. But while doing that, two things should be sacrosanct. Number one, freedom of expression, its sanctity should always be upheld by the government. Freedom of expression is the basic fundamental right of every citizen living in any democracy. At the same time,
it is interesting because this government has been accused.
At the same time, national security and individual dignity and privacy, these also have to be respected. That is where governments need to chip in and bring in certain amount of regulation.
See, the worry is when you say national security, who decides? Because
government of the day. National security.
That is the problem. Because the government of the day says if you're attacking any BJP leader, wo bhi national security.
No, it doesn't fall under that. It doesn't come under that definition. There are judicial, there are courts in this country. See, we are all, the problem with us is we are all completely, we start looking at everything from a very biased perspective. Because it is a BJP government, suppose it is a Congress government, what will happen? So should we now say that Congress leaders will misuse it? It's the government. There are checks and balances for the government. There is judiciary. There are public institutions. There is media. And if you don't do your duty, you should be blaming yourself. I put partly the blame on media also.
So you are being very charitable. I put a lot of blame on the media.
We are all there to ensure that there is it's not misused. That is how democracies function. See, Churchill used to say that democracies are the worst form of government, but there is no alternative. Alternative forms are even worse. In the available best form of government, you have to make adjustments and go on.
One more question is it necessary for the PM to have such an acrimonious campaign? I mean, that's taking off from, I think, some of the things we've been talking about.
I leave it because I don't have to now respond to it, because whether it is acrimonious or it is for proper campaign for votes and all, ultimately who will decide? The voter will decide. Voter has decided, leave it to him.
It's very interesting because there was recently a poll done by, you know, I think C-Voter or someone that said the Prime Minister's popularity, you know, was in the last 6 years has been about 60% or so. He's still the tallest leader. During lockdown last year, when he told us all to lockdown, that was the highest, 70%, you know, because his credibility was so much. And his lowest was this year in April, you know, I think 6th of April or 5th, during the West Bengal campaign, during the second wave. In 1 year, even though still he remains the tallest, Rahul Gandhi is nowhere near him. But in 1 year, there's been a huge drop. He's, and to PM's credit, the minute he reappeared and took damage control in the first week of June, those ratings have again picked up. So it's the enigma of a man. I mean, do we see, is there going to be this, not just BJP, but is India going to just in this role of a powerful leader, and until no one else comes, we're going to be having Prime Minister Modi holding sway?
Look, Prime Minister Modi is the most popular leader in the country. Not today, for the last many years, last at least 6-7 years now, continuously. Some people were very happy because his popularity seemed to have dipped for some time last month. But I don't think 1 month's happiness, let them have 1 month, have a month-long happiness. But Prime Minister remains hugely, hugely popular for a few very important reasons. I say he is a hands-on Prime Minister. He takes responsibility, he handles the issues directly. Number two,
he was missing last month.
Number two, he communicates with people directly. And most importantly, number three, in him, people see a leader who doesn't come out as someone who has got any selfishness. He is seen as a totally unselfish, dedicated, non-corrupt, honest leader. That matters in Indian polity, you must remember, Priya. We have suffered enormously at the hands of utterly corrupt leaders. Today, when you see a leader who is non-corrupt, who is honest, who is seen as working hard, people admire him. And those are all the qualities that endear Prime Minister Modi to, you know, millions and millions of people in the country.
So then is it going to be Modi against Modi, that, you know, he's going to be his biggest competition, what he does, what he doesn't do, his image versus reality is going to be what the whole election narrative is going to be about, because there is no one else. So we'll fault him on what he doesn't do and credit him for what he does do.
Okay, these issues will be discussed when elections come. First of all, in 2019, I remember very vividly, even people like me used to think that, the opposition was getting united at various levels, so it would be a tough fight. But Modi ji carried it on his shoulders and brought a bigger victory for BJP. So he was even more popular in 2019 than probably in 2014. Normally, what we call in politics as incumbency factor. It did not work against him. He beat the incumbency factor also. So I think he's a leader who has the pulse of the people, who has the knowledge of the pulse of the people. And people like him. He's a leader who understands people and people who like him.
On that note, thank you so much, Ram Madhavji, for this conversation and to the Quorum Club for hosting it. It's interesting from the questions that, you know, also that we saw that big tech, whether it's privacy, whether it is freedom of speech, whether it's the Prime Minister himself, these are really some of the concerns that we have. And of course, the handling of the pandemic. But we hope to, as I said, on behalf of Quorum Club, that it's really, thank you for being here and hope to have more conversations like this. Thank you.
Thank you, Priya. I enjoyed it. Namaskar.